El Nino 2023 is going to be a beast, is what all the reports I've been reading have been telling me. But what does it actually mean? What is El Nino? And what do we have in store for us around the world this summer? I'll be honest with you, I didn't really know nearly enough about this myself. So this one's going to be fun. Let's figure this all out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is sponsored by Anchor Solix. Since early this year, climatologists have been warning of the imminent onset of an El Nino event, the warm phase of the El Nino Southern Oscillation, or ENSO system. The first El Nino watch was issued on April 13th, when one of the conditions for El Nino was initially met. We'll get back to that in a minute. But on June 8th of this year, the arrival of El Nino was officially confirmed by scientists at NOAA. Based on their predictions, 2023 is going to be a really hot year, and it's very likely that 2024 will be the hottest year ever recorded. So, what is the ENSO system? The ENSO system is the world's most important climate cycle. It's a recurring climate pattern involving changes in the temperatures of the central and eastern tropical Pacific Ocean. This phenomenon has three potential phases: a cold, hot, and neutral phase. During a neutral ENSO phase, sometimes called la nada or nothing in Spanish, something I just learned, the ocean temperatures are average and we get typically mild weather patterns around the world. The hot phase is what we call El Niño, which is Spanish for the child or the boy. The name comes from 17th century Peruvian fishermen who noticed warmer waters and poor fishing during Christmas and associated it with the birth of baby Jesus. When waters get colder, we get the opposite effect, so we call that phase La Niña, which means the girl. The ENSO cycle usually lasts between 2 and 7 years, averaging about 5, with El Niño and La Niña phases lasting an average of 9 to 12 months. It's during these months that we see stronger weather events in some parts of the world. But the last La Niña phase lasted 3 years instead of 9 to 12 months, earning it the nickname the Triple Dip La Niña. Now, the ENSO is bouncing back to an El Niño, and it's going to be bad. To understand why this year's El Niño is going to be such a beast, let's look at how El Niños work. But before we get into that, I gotta tell you about our sponsor this week, Anchor Solix, and this, the F2000 Portable Power Station. This thing is jam-packed with some of the coolest tech. With 2 kilowatt hours of energy storage and a max output of 2400 watts, you can power 99% of your stuff. My favorite feature is its portability. With its unibody drop-proof design, pull-out handle, and rugged wheels, it's a breeze to move around. Plug in your internet modem, wireless router, and fridge during a power outage, and you'll barely even be inconvenienced. You can even charge it with solar panels on your next great outdoor adventure, or plug it in and thanks to its HyperFlash technology, it'll charge up from 0 to 80% in just an hour. And thanks to EV-grade lithium iron phosphate batteries, you can use it daily for over 10 years. They even have some special exclusive discounts for Anchor Solix fans, so check that down using the links in the description. Huge thanks to Anchor Solix and you for supporting the show. Now, we've been talking a lot about the Pacific Ocean and not about the other oceans. That's because the Pacific literally controls global climate due to its sheer size. To put the sheer scale and significance of the Pacific Ocean into perspective, it covers 47% of the water surface of the planet. That's double the area and over twice the volume of the water in the Atlantic, which is the next largest. The point is, even though El Niño happens over the Pacific, its effects stretch across the globe. For example, El Niño also affects the jet stream, which is an atmospheric river of high-speed wind that circulates around the Earth near the poles. During El Niño events, the jet stream can weaken and shift to the south, often leading to an increase in storms along the southern coast of North America during the winter. It also brings in hotter summers like we are witnessing now. This shift in the jet stream also brings warmer temperatures and drier conditions to northern areas like the northern US and Canada. It can also cause extreme weather conditions such as floods and droughts in other parts of the world. Floods are common in places like Peru, Ecuador, Colombia, Venezuela, Chile, and Bolivia in South America. Drought conditions tend to be more widespread and can occur in parts of North America, Central America, the Caribbean Islands, Australia, Africa, and parts of Asia. And finally, El Niño can also cause higher than normal hurricane activity in the Atlantic Ocean, but we'll get back to that in a moment. Now, not all of these effects are sure to show up during a particular El Niño season. Global weather is much more complicated than that, and there are other forces at play. But statistically speaking, there is a strong correlation between the strength of the El Niño phase and its effect on those global weather patterns. So just how strong will the 2023 Super El Niño be? I mean, why are the scientists saying that this year's El Niño is going to be stronger than ever? Scientists measured the intensity of an El Nino event by measuring how much warmer or colder the ocean surface temperatures are than the normal average. This is called the Oceanic Niño Index, or ONI. That is true. These temperatures are tracked within a particular patch of the Pacific Ocean along the equator called El Niño 3.4. So, for NOAA to declare an El Niño event, three things have to happen. One, the ocean must be at least 0.5 degrees Celsius hotter than normal for a given month. The normal temperature here is compared to the 30-year long-term average from 1991 to 2020. If the water is more than 0.5 degrees Celsius colder, then it's classified as La Niña. And if it's between 0.5 above or below, the ENSO is considered in its neutral phase. Second, there should be evidence that the event will persist. Scientists use complex computer models to forecast sea surface temperatures for the coming months, and that's how they predict if the conditions will last. The final condition requires the emergence of changes in weather patterns that are typically associated with an El Niño event. From late January to late May, the ENSO system came out of the triple dip La Niña and entered a neutral phase, but temperatures kept rising. NOAA then issued an El Niño warning in mid-April when the water reached a temperature over 0.5 degrees Celsius above normal. The first condition was met, but not the others. However, on June 8th, over 90% of all weather forecast models agreed that the warmer temperatures would persist. That's condition number two. Also, there were more than mild indications of changing weather patterns, particularly in Canada. If you've been watching the news lately, a warmer, drier, and earlier than normal summer caused by the descending jet stream has contributed to more than 2,700 wildfires along Alberta, Nova Scotia, Ontario, and Quebec. Now, this won't only affect Canada. As the smoke clouds are spreading, it's reached Ireland and the UK as of June 26th. But here in these states, things are also looking pretty bleak. We're currently witnessing record high summer temperatures, even though the hottest months of the year are typically weeks away. As of the making of this video, there's a massive heat wave in the central US that has over 45 million Americans under official heat alert because of an expanding heat dome over Texas. Just take a look at this temperature map from June 20th. Multiple parts of Texas are recording scorching temperatures above 110 degrees Fahrenheit. This is seriously dangerous stuff. This heat wave has already taken the lives of two hikers who went on a hike in the Big Bend National Park when temperatures hit 119 degrees. This is only the beginning. Right now, the latest measurement of the ONI for the El Niño 3.4 region is 0.9 degrees Celsius above average. But almost all models predict this temperature will keep rising in the coming months, peaking around October, November. During the northern winter, some of the most advanced models predict the ocean temperatures will reach a staggering 2.73 degrees Celsius above average. Others predict 2.5. Several more predict at least 2. And most other forecast temperatures well over 1.5 degrees Celsius. This puts the 2023 El Nino event as a potential super El Nino, which happens when central Pacific waters reach at least 2 degrees above average. To put this into perspective, here's a graph of the observed monthly ONI values since 1950. All values are 0.5 and above represent El Nino events. This graph shows two things. We've had a total of only 4 super El Nino events since 1972, with a tie for the strongest ever recorded El Nino between 97-98 and 2015-2016 seasons, with 2016 ranking as the hottest year in recorded history. The intensity of super El Nino events has been growing stronger over time, and this time it seems like it'll get even worse. As I mentioned before, we're coming into a bounce back effect from a triple dip La Niña. This matters because the ocean is the world's largest carbon sink, absorbing 25% of all the carbon emissions and 90% of the excess heat caused by those emissions. Cold water can actually absorb more carbon and heat from the air than warm water can. This is why La Niña usually comes with lower average global temperatures, because the water is colder. However, even though we just had a 3-year-long La Niña, 2022 was the 5th hottest year ever recorded. And now that the tides have turned and the ocean is getting warmer, it's also getting ready to release gigatons worth of greenhouse gases and excess stored heat into the atmosphere. Another clear sign of a stronger than usual El Nino event is that the US drought monitor reported a faster than normal decrease in drought conditions across the country. This dropped from 63% at the start of November 2022 to 19% by the end of May 2023. That's definitely good news for places in drought, but that's the fastest decline in drought conditions since we began tracking them in 2000. And it points to a strong El Nino effect on the jet stream I mentioned before. So, the 2023 Super El Nino is going to be massive. How massive? The only way to put it into context is to compare it to the closest competitor, the 2015-2016 El Nino. Let's recap what happened during that year. First, during this season, the southern states, especially along the Gulf Coast, received much higher precipitation than normal during the winter months. For example, Texas had its wettest winter on record, with an average of 16.8 inches of rain, which was 7.4 above normal. Florida also had its second wettest winter on record, with 4.7 inches more rain than normal. That is set to happen again in the 2023-2024 winter season, only worse. But that's the milder side. 2016 has the second highest annual number of billion-dollar weather-related disasters in U.S. history. There were a total of 203 disasters, 15 of which were extreme events, including Hurricane Matthew in October, the North and Central Texas hailstorm of April, and the ongoing megadrought here in California, to name a few. In total, these natural disasters killed 138 people and caused $46 billion in direct damages. And that was with a peak sea surface temperature of 2.3 degrees above average. Imagine what 2.7 would do. With the exception of Hurricane Katrina in 2005, which has been the costliest natural disaster in U.S. history, most billion-dollar disasters are linked to El Niño events, and the overall cost in human lives and damages has been increasing steadily. Yale Climate Connections contributor Michael Lowry explained in simple terms why this year's El Niño could also trigger one of the worst hurricane seasons in the Atlantic. He stated, "The tropical Atlantic has been running an astounding full degree Celsius or warmer above its long-term average, blistering warmth that in any other year would signal an active hurricane season ahead." And that means that it's not just the Pacific that's getting worked up. We really have to brace ourselves. We're heading toward a pretty ugly situation, and we desperately need to prepare. If you're in any of the regions where you're likely to see the impacts of the Super El Nino event, it's probably a good idea to at least consider getting flood insurance or fire insurance or something similar. It's also important to take official warnings seriously and make sure we have a backup plan to cool off if you have to spend time outside during a particularly hot day. But as an engineer, I also like to take a more proactive approach to preparation, one that doesn't only depend on public utilities or the government. Setting up backup systems for power, for example, is why I talk so much about batteries and solar. Better communications, water and food, or totally going off-grid are all things you can do in some small way. So for example, one of the big concerns whenever the heat starts to rise is people running their air conditioning, especially in the US where people are not keen to turn the thermostat up and overloading the grid and causing brownouts to happen. So for me, I now have a 11 kilowatt solar system which produces all the power I need. Next up for me is home batteries. And if I got those two things together, even if the power goes out, I could still run my house and my business. And that's why I love that technology so much. It's the emergency preparedness of it all. That said, predictions and forecasts are only that, predictions based on models, and those models could be wrong. We could end up with a mild El Nino that doesn't really do all that much harm. There is a more than 50% chance that this year's El Nino will be a beast, but there's also a chance that it won't. I don't make these videos to come out as alarmist or to scare people. I'm bringing you all the data, how this works. I honestly didn't know. And now I fully understand what El Ninos are, that there's a La Nada. Didn't know that, and how this year is shaping up. So definitely keep apprised of the news where you live and be prepared. There's going to be increases in air conditioning usage, power outages. Those are things that are probably going to happen, especially as the temperatures start to rise in regions that have air conditioning. You know, I love you. Take care of you and yours. Be safe out there. And until next time, I'm Ricky with Tuba Da Vinci, and check out this video next.